Hachette Audio presents Blowing the Bloody Doors Off and Other Lessons in Life, written and read by Michael Caine. The first time I was in the United States, when I'd just made Alfie, I was sitting on my own in the lobby of the Beverly Hills Hotel and heard the sound of a helicopter landing in the gardens opposite. This, the porter told me, was strictly illegal. He and I stood at the door to see who was so flagrantly flouting the law. Presumably the President of the United States, or at least the Beverly Hills Hotel. Across the Sunset Boulevard, out of a swirling sun-flecked cloud of dust, 6'4" and in full cowboy get-up, strode the unmistakable figure of John Wayne. As I stood there, with my mouth open, he caught my eyes and altered his course to come over to me. "What's your name, kid?" he asked. "Michael Caine," I croaked. "That's right," he agreed, with a tilt of his head. "You were in that movie, Alfie." "Yes," I said. I wasn't really keeping up my end of the conversation. "You're going to be a star, kid," he drawled, draping his arm around my shoulder. "But if you want to stay one, remember this. Talk low, talk slow, and don't say too much." "Thank you, Mr. Wayne," I said. "Call me Duke." He gave me a chuck on the arm, turned around, and swaggered off. It was a mind-blowing Hollywood moment for an ambitious young actor on his first visit to the City of Dreams. And it was great advice for anyone who's going to be acting in westerns and delivering all his dialogue from a horse. Talk low and slow so you don't scare the horses, and say as little as possible before the horses run away. But it was not such great advice for someone like me, an actor who was going to play all kinds of characters with tons of dialogue and mostly, thankfully, with my feet planted firmly on the ground. I'm often asked what advice I have for actors starting out in this business. And for many years, my answer was, never listen to old actors like me. That was because, until John Wayne offered me his words of wisdom, I always used to ask older actors what I should do. And the only thing they ever told me was to give up. But as I've got older, I've been reflecting on my life, as older people often do. And I realized that over my 60 years in the movie business and my 85 years of life, I've been given a lot of useful advice by Marlene Dietrich, Tony Curtis, and Laurence Olivier, among many others. And I have learned a lot of useful lessons from many glittering successes and many disastrous failures. I started to think I could do a bit better than never listen to advice. In fact, my advice would be, don't listen to that advice. This book is a result of that reflection. I wanted to look back on my life from the Elephant and Castle to Hollywood, and from Man About Town Alfie to Batman's butler, Alfred, with all its successes and all its failures, all its fun and its misery and struggle, its comedy, its drama, its romance, and its tragedy. And find, among it all, the lessons I've learned and wanted to share, not just for aspiring movie actors, but for everyone. A few of my lessons are quite specific to movie acting, but I hope that most of them will speak somehow to most of you. You won't all have to audition for parts, but in some ways, life is always an audition. Everyone has moments when they have to put themselves out there for what they want. You won't all have to learn lines, but everyone sometimes has to make sure they're properly prepared. We all have to deal with difficult people, and we all have to learn how to balance our professional and personal lives. What you need to be a star in movies is not that different from what you need to be a star in any other universe. It just takes a little more luck. And if you don't give a monkey's about this old man's so-called wisdom, well, I hope you'll still be entertained. Along the way, I tell stories from my life, some old, some new, many star-studded, and all entertaining, I hope, that helped to build the bigger story of how I got from where I started to where I ended up, and the mistakes I made, and the fun I had, and what I learned along the way. What worked for John Wayne was never going to work for me, so I don't assume that what worked for me will necessarily work for you. The world I came up in was very different from today's, and my battle as a young white working-class male movie actor in the 1950s and 1960s will not be the same as yours. And I know that my life has been blessed with more than its fair share of good luck and good timing. As a young working class lad in the 1960s, I was in the right place at the right time. I know that. Thousands of actors out there were as good and better than me, but didn't get the breaks. I know that too. And I know that while suddenly the 1960s parts were being written and worlds were opening up for working class lads like me, those breakthroughs were decades away from women and people of color. It has taken me many decades to understand the battles, not just for the roles, but for the dignity and basic decency that women have been fighting in the movies and many other industries for years, and I'm still learning. I have been extraordinarily lucky in my personal life too, meeting my wife Shakira and having the most wonderful life with her for 47 years. I have been blessed with two incredible daughters, three precious grandchildren, and a group of close, supportive friends. No one can succeed in movies or anywhere else without luck. But I haven't just been lucky. I've been unlucky plenty of times too. And I've never rested on my laurels. I've worked hard, learned my craft, grabbed my opportunities, and kept on bloody going when the others gave up. Nobody has the one secret formula for success. No one can promise you riches and fame. And actually, I wouldn't recommend waiting for them. A lot of actors know as much about the business as I do, and more. But if you would like to look at how one very lucky man got there, overcoming the bad luck and wringing everything he could out of good, making tons of mistakes but trying to learn from them, doing what he loved, and having a lot of fun along the way, let's get going. Part 1. Starting out. Chapter 1. It doesn't matter where you start. When I look around me now and look back to where I've come from, and then, just to be sure, check out the view again, I sometimes think, what? Me? No. You're having me on. It still sometimes seems like an impossible dream. Lesson number 1. I am living proof that whatever you start in life, you can make it. Emphasis on can, not will. No promises. I was born about a million years ago, in 1933, in the middle of the worst depression this country has ever known, and 6 years before it's brought to an end by an even bigger catastrophe, the Second World War. My mother was a charlady who, though I didn't learn this until after her death, already had one son, who she was loving and caring for in secret. My father was an intelligent but completely uneducated, or undereducated, which was typical of the working class at that time, fish porter at the Billingsgate Market. We lived in a cramped two-room flat in a converted Victorian house in Camberwell, then one of the poorest parts of grimy, smoggy London. Three flights up from the street and five flights up from one toilet in the garden. I suffered from rickets, a disease of poverty that causes weak bones, and I tottered up and down those stairs in surgical boots. 3 years after me came another son, Stanley. And 3 years after Stanley came the Second World War. As the Blitz flattened London, my brother and I, aged 3 and 6, were evacuated and found ourselves at the tender mercies of separate and rather disappointing new families. Mine fed me one toast a day and kept me locked up in a cupboard under the stairs when they went away for the weekends. My mother barged in and rescued me, covered with sores, as soon as the Germans stopped bombing the railway lines, but not before I developed lifelong claustrophobia and an absolute detestation of any cruelty to children. I left school at 16 with a small handful of exam passes, found and got sacked from a handful of menial office jobs, and at 18 I got called up for national service, where I first did my level best to help with the Allied occupation of defeated post-war Germany, and then headed off to be shot at by communists in Korea. Britain then was one of the most class-ridden nations in the world, and I was daily informed, at the bottom of the heap. Of course, there were millions of people all over the world living much worse lives than mine, but I didn't know about that. I just knew that I was poor and working class. In many ways, it was not a great start for anything, let alone movie stardom. But to its star, Morris Joseph Micklewhite, as, poor sod, I was known back then. My childhood never felt like a sob story. It was what I knew.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.